Howdy, folks. The road to the top of the college basketball rankings, as well as control of the Big 12, heads through Waco this weekend. Welcome to All 12 Courtside. I'm Rob Collins.
And I'm Harold Kutz. We got a massive game this weekend in the Lone Star State. Number one Baylor welcomes number three Kansas Saturday. It's expected to be one of the biggest games in college basketball this season. So coming up, we're going to talk more about the Big 12 race essentially being decided Saturday morning in Waco. We got coaching candidates potentially being talked about over in Texas. And we look next year for the bottom feeders. But that number one ranking, Rob, and control of the Big 12 is at stake as Baylor gets ready to welcome KU on Saturday morning. We got College Game Day in the house there. I think I saw something where the level of this game is at a 99% rating in terms of quality of game this year. So, you know, you might want to tune in for that.
What would be 100?
I don't know. I mean, I guess one of the great championships of years past, I'd imagine, in the NCAA tournament.
Well, certainly going to be a lot of noise in Waco on Saturday for sure. Mandy Knight from KWKT reports Baylor isn't shying away from Kansas while pointing out it's a record-setting season.
Well, back here in Waco, the top-ranked Baylor Bears have been rewriting history all season, from winning the program's first-ever game at Allen Fieldhouse to setting the longest win streak in Big 12 history at 23 games. Now, the saying, focus on one game at a time, is a cliche for all sports, but it holds true for the Bears. They did not look past Oklahoma to Kansas with College Game Day coming to Waco. Instead, they focused on what beating the Sooners would mean.
Coach Drew did a good job of, you know, making sure we were locked in on this game. And then this game was important because it's the longest win streak, you know, and we had a chance to make history before the big showdown, y'all so called it. So I think that was a big thing for us as a milestone and for Baylor.
Our goal, like every team, is a conference championship. So it's on to the next one, and we've been blessed to focus one game at a time, and hopefully we'll keep doing that.
Baylor shattering the Jayhawks' previous 22-game win streak from the 90s is something Scott Drew did not have on his radar.
First and foremost, I'd never even thought of a streak like this because the Big 12 has been the number one conference for six straight years, because top to bottom, there's no easy game. And you have great fan support. You have great players. You have great coaches. When you've been in the league for 17 years, you can appreciate the history as well.
We've seen the team come together no matter who's on the court. And on Saturday, it will be an exciting matchup as the Jayhawks look to beat the Bears the second time around on the national stage with College Game Day. And that's the latest from the top-ranked Bears from here in Waco. For All 12 Live, I'm Mandy Knight.
All right, meanwhile, KU, they took care of business in two consecutive home games when they beat Oklahoma and Iowa State at home by both double digits, and now they find themselves in an unusual position heading to Waco. They're the underdog, right?
Yeah, they're not very much the dogs often, especially at home at Allen Fieldhouse. Never the dogs. Jayhawks have a little revenge on their mind after dropping that one to Baylor at the Fieldhouse earlier this season. But hopefully they learned some lessons for the KU faithful. Bears held the Jayhawks at 39% shooting. They forced 14 turnovers, 5 for the Bears. And despite KU having 10 blocks, a late first half run gave the Bears a little breathing room. Kansas never found their way back. So what has to change for Bill Self's squad moving forward?
I would like to run good offense. I'd like to attack them better. I'd like to, you know, not have live ball turnovers that lead to 20 points or plus or whatnot. So there's a lot of things we didn't do in the first game. But it wasn't as much as what we didn't do as what they did do to make us do what we didn't do. They were really good defensively. They were better than us.
A lot, I guess you can say a lot's on the line this game, but we're going to, you know, prepare like it's you know, another game. We can't let the emotions get the best of us. You know, we got to just play our game, play what we know, what we like to do, and, you know, just execute our game plan.
Alrighty, let's look at some of the keys to the game, and we start with the man you just heard from, Harold.
Yeah, number one versus number three, Devon Dotson, healthy now, and that's huge because he was dealing with that hip pointer, if you remember, that affected his movement in the last game. Meanwhile, Jared Butler went off for Baylor, 22 points in that one, so both players could make a big statement in Player of the Year award in the Big 12, but a great performance Saturday.
Yeah, getting Doak involved is going to be big as well. Everyone knows what he can do offensively and defensively, but Baylor fronted him. They didn't let him get too many touches in the paint, and that's where he makes his money. That's where he lives. Baylor will try to emulate what they did against him the first time, and if Doak starts having a good game, here comes Hack-a-Doak.
Watch out for the alley and the oop and Marcus Garrett. Now, also, you got some perimeter shooting here. Both teams aren't statistically the best at shooting from the three-ball, good-ball range, but KU has been gotten a little better here. Isaiah Moss, even Marcus Garrett, he's got hot for the outside. Now, time to see if they can have that perimeter shooting travel on the road.
It's going to be a big game, man. And it's interesting that it's the Big 12. None of the other Power Fives really have any teams as good as either one of these teams. So you may be looking at two number one seeds.
Yeah, right now they have two number one seeds along with San Diego State and Gonzaga. It's going to be interesting to see who wants to play where, basically, as they play. So no harm lost with the loss because you're losing to a superior team in the nation.
See how it plays out, my man. All right, let's move on. Chris Beard's Texas Tech Red Raiders dealing with an ugly loss and then an ugly win in their last two outings. But at this time of the year, hey, man, you'll take a dub.
Yeah, easily set and done, though. David Collier, KAMC, more on the Red Raiders from Lubbock.
Texas Tech taking a hit to its postseason seeding with an ugly three-point loss at Oklahoma State Saturday in Stillwater, trying to avoid another blemish to the resume against last-place Kansas State Wednesday night in Lubbock. Wildcats came to town losers of five straight, but giving the Red Raiders all they could handle. After leading by as many as 11 in the first half, Texas Tech saw that lead fall to just two with under 10 to play, and Kansas State had a chance to tie on a Cartier jar of steal and dunk, but he finds out the hard way that West Texas does windmills a little bit better than Wildcats. Comes up short on the dunk attempt. Tech turns that into three at the other end, so instead of a tie ball game, the Red Raiders take a five-point lead and take any momentum Kansas State would have the rest of the way as Texas Tech holds on to win 69-62.
Everybody's season ends up in a must-win. For some teams, it's in the conference tournament. For other teams, it might even be in the regular season. For those of us fortunate enough to compete in the NCAA tournament, it happens then. But everybody gets yourself into a survive and advance moment. And one thing we've done with our teams over the years is try to put ourselves in those moments early so when that moment does come, we're prepared, and we've been there before. So we did approach tonight's game like it was a game that we really had to have.
Freshman Kevin McCullough made his first career start on Wednesday against K-State, led the team in rebounding and steals for a third straight game. He's also averaging 11 points in the Red Raiders' last three games as well. McCullough could be the spark this Red Raider basketball team needs as they head into the home stretch of conference play starting Saturday at Iowa State in Ames. That'll do it from here in Lubbock. Let's send it back to you in Kansas City.
All right, David, thank you very much. Well, West Virginia Mountaineers, they snapped a losing streak Tuesday night with a much-needed win over Okie State.
Yeah, we go to Nick Farrell with an update on the Mountaineers from Morgantown.
Throughout this season, West Virginia's starting lineup has been fairly consistent in featuring two big men, forwards Derek Culver and Oscar Shibway. But Tuesday night against Oklahoma State, Bob Huggins opted for a smaller lineup, placing Culver on the bench and adding an extra guard into the mix, hoping that would spark the WVU offense, which had fallen stagnant during a three-game losing streak. But the small lineup didn't fix much. The Mountaineers fell behind early and returned to their big lineup in the second half before pulling away from Oklahoma State in a 65-47 win. That outcome is what matters most, not how the Mountaineers got there, as WVU notched its first victory in 2 weeks.
It was a different lineup. We were trying to do different things, and probably in hindsight, that probably wasn't a smart thing to do. Now, after we changed lineups, and we could do a better job of guarding them and a better job of rebounding, we ran better offense.
Next up, a two-game road swing for WVU with matchups at TCU and Texas just ahead. That's the latest on the Mountaineers. For All 12 Courtside, I'm Nick Farrell. Back to you in Kansas City.
All right, Nick, thank you much. Now we head to the Longhorns. Not a very big crowd to watch that game with TCU, but the Longhorns did get back on track with a win over the Frogs.
Yeah, we go to Austin with KXAN's Roger Wallace with the Horns.
Texas Longhorns lost their fourth straight game on Saturday at Iowa State. They got blown out by the Cyclones 81-52. It was their fourth straight game, failing to get to 60 points. And then Wednesday night happened. Without yet another starter, Matt Coleman, that makes four starters at some point in the season not playing. Texas beats TCU 70-56. Freshman Will Baker was 1-for-25 from three coming in with 16 total points. He hit 4-of-6 from three and scored a career-high 20 in the win.
Felt good to get those off. I just stayed ready and kept on working on my shot.
and my time came.
It's about next man up, you know, staying confident, staying ready, and, you know, living, stepping up to the big moment.
It's not about making excuses. It's not about saying, okay, this guy's not on the floor or that guy. It's about win anyway.
Now the Longhorns hit the road as they play at Kansas State on Saturday, and then the quick turnaround with West Virginia in Austin on Monday. That's the story from the capital of Texas. Back to you in Kansas City.
All right, let's look at Shaka Smart's resume because, you know, his job's kind of been on the line.
He's on the hot seat.
Yeah, for sure. 85 and 76 in five seasons, two NCAA appearances, both eliminated in the first round. Longhorns, however, did win the NIT last season over Lipscomb. Shout out Nashville. He's under contract through 2023, but judging by last night's announced attendance at 8,395, and it didn't look like 8,395 at all. Some questions about job security have come up. Names mentioned just off the top of the head. John Beilein, of course, sure. Who's not with the Cleveland Cavaliers anymore. Becky Hammond, who's an assistant coach for the San Antonio Spurs. Those are two to look out for.
I would shake things up a bit in college basketball.
I think it would be an impressive move, too. By
Texas. Be good stuff. Yeah. All right. Oklahoma Sooners had opportunities to get some resume wins. The team faced a pair of difficult back-to-back games. Obviously, they went to Kansas, and they tried to stop that losing skid in Lawrence. And then number one Baylor. That's a tough road.
That's the toughest road the Big 12 has to offer. Saturday, the Sooners head to Stillwater. They're facing a little bedlam there. Here's Brian Brinkley.
Oklahoma got a pair of home wins the previous week, but the Sooners faced a tough combination of games this week with a visit to Kansas and a home game against top-ranked Baylor. The Sooners were in Lawrence on Saturday trying to end a long drought in Allen Fieldhouse, but Marcus Garrett made sure the OU losing streak continued. He poured in a career-high 24 points and hit 6 three-pointers as the Jayhawks won 87-70, handing Oklahoma their 19th straight loss in Lawrence. The Sooner coach says the game's turning point came late in the first half.
Sure, we always talk about trying to focus on each possession. And again, I thought right there we're up one, you know, latter third of the first half, and then back-to-back steals on their part. I thought we lost a little bit of, you know, focus right there, and then they make a little run, you know, prior to the end of the first half. But yeah, you got to have focus, and this league is so good, and certainly Kansas is so good. You got to have great focus on every possession.
Lon Kruger's team hosted top-ranked Baylor on Tuesday night after the Bears went on a 23-5 run. OU answered back late in the first half. Brady Manick the alley-oop dunk there, and OU trailed by just 6 at the half. But after cutting the Bears' lead to 1 in the second half, OU saw Baylor go on a 13-2 run to stretch the lead back out and go on to win 65-54 for their Big 12 record 23rd straight win. Sooner senior Christian Doolittle says he and his teammates have to move on past this disappointing loss.
I feel like we do a pretty good job on, you know, moving on, whether from a win or a loss. You know, we just got to take the positive things from each game and try to, you know, implement those in our next game. So, you know, tomorrow we have an off day tomorrow. So, you know, it's time to, you know, relax and, you know, think about different things. But, you know, Thursday we got to come in ready to prepare for OSU.
Doolittle was named Big 12 Player of the Week on Monday, and as he mentioned, next up for the Sooners is round two of Bedlam at Oklahoma State on Saturday, then back home to face Texas Tech on Tuesday. For All 12 Courtside, I'm Brian Brinkley in Oklahoma City.
All righty, thanks, Brian. Meantime, Iowa State continues without Tyrese Haliburton, and they had a nice effort against Texas at home, but then not so good against Kansas.
Yeah, of course. Keith Murphy, WHO, on the story with the Cyclones.
The Cyclones missed their best player, Tyrese Haliburton. He's a projected lottery pick for a reason, and though Haliburton remains a strong team leader, he can't impact a game cheering in street clothes the way he can when running the show. Haliburton's done, but the Cyclones proved against Texas they are not. Iowa State bounced back from a 29-point loss with a 29-point win. A 58-point swing is not something we see in back-to-back games very often, but not unheard of in the no nights off Big 12. On Big Monday, another challenge, Iowa State at number 3 Kansas. The Cyclones could not have shot much better than they did in the first half. 9 of 12 from 3 and still down by 10 points. That's a bad sign and a sign of a mismatch. KU added another 10 to the pad and the Clones fell by 20. So Iowa State heads toward March with 2 more road games and 3 at Hilton Coliseum. It starts Saturday with a rematch against national runner-up Texas Tech. In the first meeting, the Red Raiders thumped the Cyclones by 20. Iowa State will look for a lift from its loyal home crowd at Hilton Coliseum, though the Hilton magic has largely gone missing this season. Steve Prohm would love to stay out of day one games at the Big 12 tournament in Kansas City, but with no Halliburton and few conference wins, even with Halliburton, it's hard to picture Iowa State winning three or four games the next couple weeks. The Cyclones plan to prove me wrong. For All 12 Courtside, I'm Keith Murphy.
All right, Keith, thanks much. Oklahoma State was hoping to carry over some of their recent success against a pair of NCAA tournament-bound teams.
Yeah, K4's Brian Brinkley tells us how the Cowboys were hosting Texas Tech on a day in which the Cowboys paid tribute to their 1995 Final Four team, and then they went to West Virginia and gave them a battle in Morgantown.
Oklahoma State finally is experiencing some success during conference play, and the Cowboys faced two tough ones this past week playing a pair of ranked opponents. Mike Boynton's Cowboys were blown out at Texas Tech by 35 last month. It was a different story in Stillwater on Saturday. Caleb Boone had a career-high 16 points and made 12 of 14 free throws for OSU, and Jonathan Laurent had his season high with 16 points as OSU won 73-70, and after the game, Laurent said when Boone is playing like that, the Cowboys are a much better team.
I would say it's about time, you know, because we, like all the coach always says, man, he's one of the guys in the room that has by far the most potential in the room, and it's a mindset for him, man. When he wants to play hard, he plays hard, you know, but he has to come with that every single day, and he's bringing it to the games, and it's impacting us as a team, impacting him as a player.
Boone was named Big 12 Newcomer of the Week on Monday. Mike Boynton's Cowboys were at West Virginia on Tuesday night. They shot 62% in the first half. Cameron McGriff had 19 points, and OSU led by as many as 10. But the Mountaineers went on a 32-9 run spanning the two halves, and OSU shot just 17% in the second half. Jermaine Haley's three to end the first half sparked the WVU run as they went on to win 65-47.
We missed some layups. We had a couple turnovers, and we missed a couple free throws that, again, it's, instead of at halftime it being a five-point game, maybe if it's 10 or 12, maybe they don't feel as good coming out of the locker room, and then they make the three at the end, very end of the half, which kind of, you know, in some ways swung the momentum, and then they obviously got to a really good start in the second half as well.
The Cowboys are home this Saturday to host Bedlam rival Oklahoma, and then they're back on the road to face Kansas and Lawrence on Monday night. For All 12 Courtside, I'm Brian Brinkley in Oklahoma City.
All right, Brian, the frustration continues to boil over for the K-State Wildcats. It could be seen on the sidelines during the loss of the Red Raiders.
Definitely seen. Cartier Jarre and Bruce Weber having a little shouting match during a timeout, which resulted in Weber throwing a stool at the floor. KSNT's Pete Francis has Weber's reaction, plus an update on Xavier Sneed.
The rough season continues for the Kansas State Wildcats. K-State fell to TCU over the weekend 68-57 after being outscored by 12 points in the second half. Then another low came from an already frustrating season with a 69-62 loss at Texas Tech. Cartier Jada was seen yelling at Bruce Weber during a timeout, which resulted in Weber throwing his stool at the floor.
Bruce, the video on the telecast caught you and Cardi going back and forth in one of the timeouts, him kind of clapping at you. What was to that, and what was your reaction?
Great passion, great energy in the bench, trying to play hard, trying to get them to play at a high level.
So there wasn't like any bad blood there or anything?
They're trying to compete. Everyone wants to do well. That's just part of it.
And when you thought things couldn't get any worse for K-State, Xavier Sneed left the game in the final minute with an injury.
He just cramped. He cramped before that, and I didn't get him out. He finished. We got a timeout, and he finished it out, but he cramped on that one, too. So he played hard. That's all you can ask.
The loss to the Red Raiders drops the Cats to 9-17 on the season. The good news for the Cats, they're back at home Saturday. The bad news, they're playing Texas, and the Longhorns beat K-State by 14 points in the first meeting. That's the latest from Manhattan. For All 12 Courtside, I'm Pete Francis. Back to you in KC.
All righty, Pete. Iowa State, Oklahoma State, Kansas State all near the bottom of the conference, but help's on the way next season. The Pokes have the number one rated recruit. This is according to 247 Sports, headed to Stillwater next year. It's Cade Cunningham, and then alongside four-star Rondell Walker. Now, K-State and Iowa State both have recruiting classes in the top 22. Iowa State, 4-star Xavier Foster. Wildcats led by Nigel Pack. But let me tell you this.
Hold on a second. Did I miss a read? Are you taking me out?
No, I'm not taking you out. I just want to know, what do we have here at Stools? Stools have been a part of furniture for years. See this one here? It's nice. It's got firm. It's well-built. It's American-made. What are we doing with Stools? Why are we tossing Stools? Will somebody please think about the Stools? Just think about the Stools.
That's enough Stool sample for you.
Gosh. Put it down calmly. It's had enough abuse.
Stay there.
Okay. Jeez.
Can we continue?
Yeah,
are you okay?
Yeah. I just want to make sure
okay?
the Stools
are
okay.
Do you need
okay,
a hug, Rob?
What are we doing with Stools? TCU continues its fall down to Big 12 standings as they seem to have a common theme. Start fast, but then slow.
Fell off the stool, did they?
Yeah, they did.
They went through that again on Wednesday. TCU struggles. And they suffered that loss against Texas Wednesday night. Shot 62% in the first half. They were 5-of-5 from three-point range. But in the second half, 24%. Desmond Bain led the way with 13 points and 9 boards. But all 13 of those came in the first half. So, Harold, this is where things stand. Baylor, numero uno, undefeated at the top of the standings. Kansas one game behind. Texas Tech in third, followed by West Virginia and Oklahoma.
Oklahoma followed by Texas, and then TCU, and we already talked about Iowa State, Oklahoma State, and Kansas State rounding out the standings. We're less than 3 weeks away from the Big 12 championship, Rob. So here we go. KC Sprint Center is going to be an interesting weekend. Wednesday's not going to be as interesting as it normally is because usually you got some teams that are fighting for NCAA bubble position, making sure they take care of business before they get to Thursday. But now it's just looking like Thursday we might have an interesting 4-5 seed game. But that 1-8, 2-7, 3-6, it's going to be a large favorite to say the least.
Sure, but there's always that one team who surprises you. Is it going to happen this year? It's going to be one team.
I don't see it. I mean, I'll say this. Oklahoma State has been at least giving it a good show of it lately. Mm-hmm. They've been competitive. They might be the one that, you know, if they can get a favorable seed and a nice little draw, might be able to take advantage of a decent matchup. But that's it, all I can see from six down. I mean, Texas looks like they've seen better days. TCU also looks the same.
Sure.
West Virginia, Oklahoma is going to be your 4-5. They might be looking for a big win if they play a one seed, whether that be Kansas or Baylor. So a lot to be determined, but it's just weird to see this late in the season how everything's kind of been determined, if you will. So.
We'll see how Saturday determines the shakeup between Baylor and Kansas. Of course, they don't really have tough games left. The last game of the season is the toughest one after this for both squads.
Yeah, absolutely. Kansas-Baylor, I'm really interested in that matchup. I just want to see how the guard play is. Jared Butler, Devon Dotson, that's going to be key. If Dotson's healthy, that he's going to give it a show. And perimeter shooting. They got to shoot from the outside. Both teams do. Because that's where they struggle. And that's just going forward, too, even for NCAA tournament play for both.
All right, get your popcorn ready, or in my case, beef jerky.
Well, it's morning, so you might get your coffee ready, too.
I'm all good with coffee and beef jerky.
Yeah, there you go.
All right, folks, that's it for this week's edition of All 12 Courtside. Appreciate y'all joining us. No sitting on the job next week, Harold.
Save the stools. Save them.